This is a presentation of WCTV, all-volunteer community access television from the Township of Washington.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to WCTV's Exit 168. I'm Larry LaFury. This is Emily Kratzer. We are the volunteers of WCTV. And tonight, in our first show of 2017, we'd like to look back a little bit, look forward a little bit, with two people here who started at WCTV. Emily, I guess maybe 8 years ago, they come up to volunteer, and now they're really soaring in the broadcasting business.
Absolutely. That's what we can do for people. Hey, come on down. I'm always pitching. So, yeah, everybody should join us. But what we're really proud of is when people like Alicia and Garrett are part of our volunteer team and go on to have a lot of success in college and helpfully into the broadcasting field based on the information and the learning that they got here. So, you know, let's see here. Let's toss it over to, and Alicia and Garrett, you guys can introduce yourselves and say when you got involved here at WCTV. Garrett, go.
Ladies first.
All right.
I'm Alicia. I'm a junior at Catholic University in Washington, D.C. This is probably my eighth year at WCTV. I joined my freshman year of high school. I came up for an introductory course with Mrs. Lazarski, who was the teacher for digital media at the time. She gave us a tour, and I stayed, and I came back ever since. So.
And Garrett, how'd you get stuck with us?
Hi, I'm Garrett Sackley. Same thing, too. I was in Mrs. Lazarski's class freshman, sophomore year, and then I got involved senior year. I was in independent study with her, and then she really let me get the ball rolling, take cameras, shoot footage, and then I think my best part was doing the football with you guys, pretty much so. And the
is that what you've, looking back at WCTV, that's what you enjoyed the most, the sports end or the?
The sports and the camera end and just being with you guys. I mean, I just like the behind the scenes action, pretty much. So.
And what about you, Alicia? You did a lot of work back of the camera, in front of the camera, under the camera, over the camera. What do you like?
I like behind the scenes best for sure. I mean, you guys gave me a dose of it all, from sports to in studio, to producing packages, to even hosting. Like, I could never imagine hosting. Being on camera is just something like I'm not very much used to, but.
You know, Emily mentioned bringing people up. Come on up, we want to help you, high school, especially high school freshmen, sophomores, underclassmen. We had your son come up.
Both of them.
Two sons come up and did very well. What would you tell someone who's a freshman or sophomore in high school, reasons to come up? Why should they come up here? What will they get out of it if they come up here? Especially if you tell them, then us.
People skills, dealing with public, guests, just picking up a hobby and running with it. I mean, I think if you can take a camera, shoot something, whether it be B-roll or sport, and it's more so getting the artistic side too. It's not picking up a camera and shooting. It's picking up a camera, capturing a certain angle, telling a story through certain media.
What about you, Alicia?
I agree with Garrett. A lot of the same thing. Like, these lights might scare you, these cameras might scare you, and being in a live atmosphere might scare you, but it has prepared me so much for college. Yes. And making packages. I mean, Garrett can attest to that, too. Like, you know what you need, how much time you need to do it, and what you need to do it. And that has helped me so much anticipate for the future.
I remember we should have had Russell up here, because Russell is a little older than them, and he went through, when he went up to Marist, right?
Right, he went to Marist.
And when he, tell the story, when he went there, he was already ahead of most of the students in the journalism class, right?
Because we are able to offer the hands-on skills here. We need everybody, so we put everybody to work, right? They know. And that was an advantage that my older son, Russell, had when he came out of Westwood High School and he went to Marist, and he walked into their TV studio, and he was able to sit down and go. You know, he knew all the stuff. What Alicia was just talking about, that's like, that's being a show producer. You make it all come together. People don't think about the elements. Who asked the guests to come tonight? Who made sure there was a camera crew tonight? Who made sure there was a control room team tonight? And that's the kind of thing we can offer kids, students, and you guys take it and run with it. So you're running at which schools? You mentioned Catholic University, and you're at Montclair.
Yes.
Just take a little time to explain what happened there that was that we had given you a good preparation for.
First-hand experience. I mean, I didn't know, let's say, as much on the tech side of the cameras, but in terms of dealing with people, as you said, getting everything set up pre and post production, I think that was the major part of it. I mean, everything else, the tech side, you know, what camera, what specific, I don't know, wiring or audio usage, but the best part I got of it was just dealing with the people, you guys, and even if it's a topic that you may not know about, just through prior experience, you can just get the ball rolling and just go with it.
What about you, Lee?
Absolutely. Like, the very basis of some of my courses, last year was the first year Catholic University lets you take production courses. You have theory courses that you need to work with, which was also very helpful for the experience I had here to apply it to some critical approaches to media. But most specifically, like, walking into the classroom, the media lab, and grabbing a camera, grabbing a light stand, and our teacher saying, have at it, figure out how to do three-point lighting, figure out how to do all these lighting techniques you read about in your textbook last night. It gave me a really great advantage to be able to pick up that equipment, know which way to put it, you know, just from being in the studio and being in the field, just being able to be in the classroom and get to work was the best thing you guys could have offered me.
Did you ever realize that you were doing producing work here and not knowing it?
Absolutely. I mean, this semester I produced my first documentary, you know, that was my first college level documentary, but you guys helped me so much on being persistent with guests, hosts, every element of pre-production, production, and post-production.
What about you, Garrett? You didn't realize that you were doing production work here, and that you'd be doing something like that when you get into Montclair, right?
No. I mean, just, you know, like coming up here on Fridays using the camera, when you tell people about it to them, if they don't understand, it's okay, you're using a camera. But it's more than that. It's, like I said, it's you guys show us how to do a two-shot, how to close up, how to use it properly on the real-world situation. So when I was at Fox and I would see the guys on the floor doing all that, I know how to do that. I could jump on the gaffer. I could jump on the, not that I would, that's union, but I could do all that stuff just through prior knowledge. And you have a little taste, and then the rest is just you putting your side into it. And
how about the preparation to do a show? Behind the camera and even in front of the camera, did you learn a lot from us about how we prepare in shooting a game or shooting a show and preparing it? Did you get anything out of that?
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, one of my classmates, the biggest assignment we had was this documentary this semester, and we reached out to people in the DC community. We didn't know who they were. And one of my classmates reached out to somebody in wheelchair basketball, and he had never shot sports before. And I went up to him and I said, Jimmy, I can help you. And I said, you take two cameras with you. You shoot one in your hand and you shoot one wide. And he said, wow, you know, I never would have thought of that. And I thought back to all the Jamboree games we shot at WCTV, and I said, thank God I knew that.
You heard Ida's voice saying, one shoot wide, one shoot tight, right?
Yeah.
Did you hear that? Did you hear that? You shoot wide,
I had
wide,
Ida
you shoot
right
tight.
On my shoulder.
Oh, yeah, the best thing in the world is when Ida's directing and she's in on the switcher. The switcher is another whole thing, and we can get into that in a second. But we've talked about going on the road. Even though we're sitting here in the studio today, Larry and gang and John and Ricky and Ida and all of us, we enjoy going out to the football games, the high school football games, and to the basketball jamboree. And we literally have a huge trolley that we take all this equipment. We run wires, electrical, we run cables that connect the cameras with the switchers, the whole everything. Really, really hands-on. This is it from literally nothing to a show. And you can see our results on YouTube. We're media savvy. We've got the YouTube thing, we got the Facebook thing going, we got the Twitter thing going. So that's a lot of the experience that you guys get too, which was completely different than being in studio.
Yes.
How did you feel, Garrett, I don't remember if you went on the Switcher, but how did you, I know Alicia has, how did you feel about being on the Switcher?
The first time I was so terrified. I mean, you have all of
it in front
of you.
First explain what a Switcher is.
So the Switcher, we have all of these cameras, you know, giving these lovely close-ups of all of us and the wide shots, and you need to cut between them. So you have a Switcher, and you have all of the cameras on it, and sitting there and looking at all the buttons and the fader bar and how to take between these cuts was really intimidating at first, and having Ida and you guys tell me what to do has really made me be able to go and pick it up in the workplace. And I'm sure you've been on Switcher. I've been with you when you've been on Switcher.
Yes,
how did you feel?
Yes, but after listening to you, I just learned a little bit more now with that. I did it once for one show, and it's intimidating. I mean, it's a live show. You don't want to mess up. So if you switch too soon and you jump and you're off camera doing a blooper, you don't want to get that thrown in. But it's my theory is, you know what, you make a mistake, just don't make the same mistake twice. So like Alicia said, it's intimidating, but you get past it and then you learn it's TV, it's not a big deal. You run with it.
And so, what people have to realize out there, as Emily said, today I think we have 1, 2, 3, maybe 4 cameras, maybe one inside, and we'll go to a football game or a basketball game, which we're moving. Like, we're sitting here now. It's not difficult because you have a camera trained. There's a 2-shot. I just saying take a 2-shot here, there. Right. But when in football, you have to follow the play. And then you have the tight shot, the wide shot. And all of that becomes very sophisticated. And you learn that so that when you go out, you say, I know how to do it. And sometimes we here look at that and say, oh, okay, that's not too great. We do that all the time. But it is something what we have accomplished over the years, what they have accomplished in the control room, can really disseminate information to youngsters in high school that could put them on the cutting edge of broadcasting. They really can. Because when you get there, like you said, I jump in, you know how to do a sporting event. And we just hope that one of the reasons why we're doing this, to see how you're doing, but the young kids who are watching this or hear this or their parents, to have them come up here so that in 3-4 years from now, they walk into college, they're set. You did a little, and both of you did work with Fox News and Fox.
Yes.
Well, what did you do, Garrett?
I was on Fox Business on The Kennedy Show, which loved her, loved the whole staff and crew. And
is she flaky?
She's awesome.
She's great, huh?
Yeah, she's unique. She's one of a kind. And the staff, too. I learned every day was something new. When I was doing talking points, I was working on packets, running getting her a coffee, which was one of my favorite things I loved. And it's just, you know, like every day, it's not the same show. It's a different show every day.
Different guests every day, right?
Like, you book guests, last minute the guest drops, what do you do? The guy doesn't show up on time in camera, what do you do? It's just, you have to be on your feet in production. So that was the best.
Sounds like we do over here. What do you do?
Yeah, sounds familiar.
But it's just, you know, I just love it. It's different, but it's the same. But that's what makes it really cool. And I learned a lot on the production end, doing the packets, like I said, and just trying to fit in with the norm of the office of, not the office, the crew, but what they all did.
Which location are you working out of? In the city?
Yes, in the city.
Yeah.
And you worked with
I worked
Fox Business?
Fox Business in D.C., actually. So a lot of the time, what you'd see in New York, all the shows for Fox Business Network tape in New York. So D.C. was a little bit different. You dealt with politicians, policymakers, all of these people coming in to be on these shows. So it's probably very likely that the shows you were working on, Kennedy, I sat guest for that show. At the time you were there. Other things I would work with the assignment editor producing an online web series. I would help with guest relations. It was really interesting because at such a time when Republicans will be taking office, all of these policymakers are walking in the door. So members of the future president's cabinet were walking in the door. It's just very, very influential time to be there.
So you're going to be going overseas to study. So what are you going to be studying in Italy?
I'll be studying all of my general education requirements. So philosophy, theology, English. I'll be picking up Italian. I'm a Spanish minor, so that should be interesting to see how that goes. And I think I'm taking English Lit.
Now, what year are you in now?
I'm a junior.
So this next year you'll be a senior, get ready to go out into the world and be a producer at some big network, right? And forget all about WCT.
The dream. No.
Well, tell the story about somebody that we met.
That's right.
Let me see if I could set this up. Many years ago, it's got to be 4, 8, It could be 12, maybe 15 years ago, a young kid from Ridgewood was doing high school football like we were doing, and he was a freshman like you started. And he would dress up in a shirt and tie and come and do, he did all the Ridgewood sports, all the Ridgewood sports, and he did the Jamboree with us. And for 4 years, that's what he did with another guy by the name of Guy Benson. And Dan Duva. Well, one went to Chicago, Guy. And one went, I forget where, maybe Syracuse.
Connecticut.
And, and they went. Now, Guy Benson, you know, you met him?
No, go ahead.
Guy Benson changed from sports to politics, and now he's the editor of
Town Hall.com,
right?
So
you met him, right?
I did meet him. Every day I would go to my boss, Mary, and say, okay, we got to look at the guest lists. I'd compile them from our internal software, iNews, and I said, oh, Guy Benson. I remember talking to Ida over the summer and saying, I'm working at Fox Business in D.C., and she said, watch out for Guy Benson. So he's a regular and a contributor, so he doesn't need me to go and walk him to the studio. So I, after his hit time had elapsed, I went over and I said, Mr. Benson, I do have to stop you. And I wanted to say a friendly hello from all our friends here at WCTV. And he said, oh, Larry, Ida, and all the gang. That's where I really got started. And he said, tell them hello for me. He asked specifically about you guys.
I remember, I don't know if I should even tell the story about John Francola. I had to pick him up. And he had to go to, he went to his house and the parents cross-examined John Francola. You have to know John. But John met the family and, yeah, we knew him very well. And he went from doing it on his own at the high school. He got very little help from the high school, but he did it all on his own, learned a lot, and he became the editor.
Fox News Channel contributor and Town Hall online publication editor.
So what's the future for now? What's the next six, let's go just 6 months.
That's a good start.
From now until June, what do you have planned? Are you a senior?
Yes.
Oh, God, and old. Go ahead, what are you going to do?
Finishing up, this is my break, finishing up my semester, and I'm hopefully, I just want to get a job. I just want to start getting out there. I love, the one thing I loved, I'd wake up, get my routine going, jump in the city, and I loved being in the city. It just felt at home, I don't know. And I just want to keep doing that, going forward.
Okay. And
For me, the next 6 months, I'm going to Italy. I'll come back on May 11th. I'm trying to apply for all the internships possible now.
Wait, May 12th, you come up here and help us.
That's right. I'm coming back here.
I just want you to make that on your calendar.
I'm coming to WCTV.
May 12th here.
I'll be on the switchboard. I'm not going to be on TV. It's going to be great.
Yeah, it's fine. Just come back May 12th.
And then hopefully I'll have an internship in New York. I'm applying. I'm hopeful about a fellowship at the Library of Congress as well in D.C.
Oh, that's exciting.
Yeah, I did a real course there this semester, and I wrote a paper about NBC.
You did very, very well, the both of you. We're all very proud of them.
And yeah, and we can prove how well they're doing.
We can?
Alicia brought photos and a videotape. Yeah, there you go.
I just bought a picture that I had on my desktop because I remember...
Who's the guy in the middle?
Our friend Vito. Yeah, our friend Vito. That's one of the documents I use at the Library of Congress to write my paper. That's a personal document from the president of NBC, Pat Weaver. I wrote mine about advertising. And then some pictures from D.C. I didn't know you were going to go through all of these guys. that was from Fox. I was right across the street from the Capitol building. And then that's the original copy of Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream speech from the Library
of Congress. That's the original copy at the library.
Wow.
Yeah. There's some pictures I took at the library at D.C. Yeah, just a few things. My friend and I went downtown to take some photos one day.
Mm-hmm. There you go. More of D.C.
Yeah, some more D.C. photos. Just some pretty scenes. That's the cherry blossoms from this last year. My parents came down, so we went.
These pictures were taken, over the last year?
Over the last year, yeah. Right.
This is springtime in Washington, huh?
Yes, that's cherry blossom season.
Cherry blossoms, yeah.
That's a park that a lot of people don't know about. It's Independence Park, and you can get a reflection of the Washington Monument.
I bet you go to Washington, a lot of things you don't know if you find out, right? Say, I didn't know that was it.
That's the sun rising over the Capitol the day the Pope came and addressed.
Are they finished building? They finished the Capitol?
All that scaffolding is gone.
Scaffolding's gone?
Yep. That's me at the Capitol building in the morning. We're waiting for Pope Francis. And Pope Francis came to my university a year ago in September. canonized a saint on campus.
Boy, you got a nice close-up of him. That's your
shot? Yeah, my friend, we woke up at 4 a.m. and we got there.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
That's kind of close.
Early bird.
Now, you'll like this one, Larry. That's the telegram about alerting about Pearl Harbor. An original
the one that
cabin.
Came about 8 hours late?
Yes. and that is an early telegraph sketch by Graham Bell.
And there's Vito being kissed again.
Yeah. And there's Vito.
We start with Vito, end with Vito.
Now, that's a kind of transition thing. We want to alert our viewers today that this is actually a two-part show. Larry and I are about to leave the scene, and we're going to turn the show over to Garrett and Alicia, and we're going to let them talk with our next set of guests. And during that transition time, I believe that we have a video that we'd like to share with our viewers. Not yet. Okay.
We have to talk a little bit.
We got to get the wheels going on the bus.
You see what happens when you're there? They go like this, right? They ever say stretch for you? We have to stretch a little bit. So we'll see if we can talk. What do your parents say about all this? They're ecstatic. I know. I see your father every once in a while comes in my office. Once a week, yeah, which is the bagel
cup
shop.
Cup of coffee crew.
Cup of coffee, yeah, he comes in.
Told my mom I'm going to be on TV. It's, oh my God, TV, you know. But it's cool for me because I remember just being behind the camera. Now I get to be in the front of the camera, and it's invigorating.
Hey, were you at a convention, Republican, Democrat, Independent?
this summer I got a really, really awesome experience with the Democratic National Convention and provide some help with ABC's photography department, running SD cards back to editors and to camera people. And I actually got to take some photos myself, which was awesome.
You got a chance to see some of it?
I did. I got to see all of it. I was very close to all of these politicians.
You got there when the nomination was...
I was on the floor when Hillary Clinton was nominated for president.
Were you there when the speeches were made?
Yes, all of those on the Senate, on the press floor.
Press floor. That's very interesting. I'd like to see something like that. You know, years ago they used to have parades and marches and everything.
Well, my boyfriend is from Philadelphia, and I had the privilege to stay at his house. He came and he said there were riots
all around.
Nice.
You didn't have to travel.
Fire. Protesting.
Yes, who's that guy?
There's the boyfriend. What's his name now?
That's Jimmy.
Jimmy's already been...
See, what happens when people walk into our studio is we put them on to
you
work.
You left them on there.
Jimmy said he's going to come up and help us.
Yeah, now. Every week. Since I'm not here, you're going to have fill-in. Jimmy's great. You need someone to talk a lot?
We'll take him. Listen, we're going to step out. And you're going to interview. We're going to have Larry Davino and Chris Robinson come in. They're going to talk about steps and walking and how important it is to walk. We're very proud of you. You're like our children. It's like seeing your kids go off to college. One of these days, we'll look at you like we look at Guy Benson and say, we remember them. Congratulations. You make your parents proud. You make us very proud.
We make our community proud. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Yeah, thank you
really
very much.
To you.
We're going to have a little a roll of some tape.
So some
Emily and I are getting out of here, and the show is yours.
Right.
The new generation of WCTV.
Right. So we're going to be rolling some video that Alicia got us from the convention.
Okay.
Right?
Her
short doc.
It's like my junior thesis.
Very good.
Watch that.
Alicia's...
then we're going to go for a walk.
Here we go.
Yeah.
We're literally going for a walk.
People get caught up in the forces of history. They're still people, but there's something moving through them. Truly evil.
I was a book artist for many years, and I had my own printing presses, and I would write and design and illustrate and produce these limited edition artworks that were texts. And it would take me like 3 or 4 years to make something like that. And I had smaller things that I made along the way that I called the physical language laboratory, and people would subscribe and get some smaller things. But when I decided to have a child, for one thing, I didn't really want to work with solvents anymore, even though I always used a ventilator mask to protect myself. I just didn't want to have that stuff around. And then also I just didn't have those long stretches of time to do the artwork. I had at most maybe an hour and a half at a time. And you just can't be a printer because it might take an hour to set up to print. And then you need to wash up when you're done. So I would need 5-hour stretches to work. And I just didn't have those. And so having a child really did affect my artwork in that way and just the medium that I used. Because all along, even when I was doing letterpress, I was doing doing my graphic arts on computer and making letterpress plates and printing my designs on, you know, 19th century printing technology, but using 20th century techniques to produce the images. So in terms of like how much I sell, I don't sell a lot, and I don't of the art, and I don't I try not to charge too much. It's very difficult to make money as an artist, and in a way you're kind of expected not to make money. That somehow you are getting rewarded by the world for making art, and that the world doesn't owe you support for that. Being an artist, you have to think really hard about what is value and what work means. 10% of the time, people come in and they're really interested in engaging with the work and in talking about the work. And that's pretty gratifying. And like any kind of, you know, I'm here to make the work, but I'm also here to sell the work. Artists have a gift, and somehow, because they didn't earn that skill in a way, it doesn't need to be paid. Because what you're going to be paid in is exposure. That means people will be seeing your work, and that is, that's your payment. So I don't know any artist who could actually survive on exposure. In fact, people die of exposure. But artists internalize this a lot, and so they feel like, and this goes back to how you have to spend time putting your work out, how you have to market yourself. And it's not just your work, you sort of have to market yourself, because in a way, what you have as an artist is who you are.
And welcome back to WCTV. Thank you for watching. Right now with us are our two very guests going to be talking to us about Healthy Steps and their program. So
yeah, if you feel free to introduce yourselves, talk to us about Healthy Steps and what the mission is here in town.
Okay, I guess I'll start. Good evening, Jan Sonquist, Mayor of the Township of Washington, and this program is Mayor's Wellness Program, and I'm very excited about it, and it was a great opportunity when Chris called me up and introduced himself and said, I'm Chris Robertson, I live in town, I'm Director of ER Nursing at Valley, and I'd like to talk to you about a wellness campaign, a healthy wellness campaign. And I was really very happy about it because I've been trying to get one for a while. So it was like a dream come true. You talked about a dream come true. And it's Chris and Larry put in a lot of work in the last couple of months to get this going. And we have a good partnership, as you probably see, with the township, with Foodtown, with Valley Hospital, and the library in town. And I think it's going to be a great event. And hopefully in the future we can have some more of these if they work well. And tomorrow should be a very exciting day, I hope, very exciting morning. Although it's supposed to snow, we still will do the walking. Hopefully people will be, you know, hardy enough to do some walking, even if it's snowing lightly. If not, we'll walk within the library. And I'll let them tell you more about this.
But thank you very much for all being here and watching and doing this. We're very excited about this event. Larry?
Okay, I'm Larry DeVino. I'm an emergency room nurse at Valley Hospital. Been at Valley since 1991. Chris asked me to help him put this program together. We were out last Saturday handing out flyers. It's a wellness program that is being spearheaded by the mayor and Chris, and we're hoping to get a lot of turnout because it's going to make people healthy and get their cholesterol checked, their blood pressure, and their heart checked. So it's a good program. And I'll turn it over to Chris.
So I'm Chris Robertson. I work with Larry. I'm the nursing director at the emergency department at Valley Hospital. This all started, I'm a student at Rutgers. I'm doing my doctorate in nursing practice. And one of the projects that I had to work on was working with the town I live in and introduce something healthy for the town. And, you know, it was amazing, really. I had a lot of the other students I'm in school with had real trouble reaching out to the mayors of their towns. But within seconds of calling Janet, she was on board, very receptive, and I felt very lucky to have this opportunity to work with her. What I didn't know was how quickly other people wanted to become involved, and this has just grown from quite a simple project into quite a large event. So it's great for the community. I'm glad to be a town resident and be able to offer this to the town, my family, my friends. So really the event is, I reached out with Janet's help. We reached out to several local sponsors and everybody again wanted to be part of this. So Valley Hospital was great. They provided the advertising, they made these flyers and they sent postcards to all the residents of the town. Food Town, Nicholas Markets, they were, you know, very keen to be part of it. And they're providing healthy snacks and shakes, salads, hot drinks, granola bars. And they're also sending a nutritionist tomorrow for the event. Tomorrow there's going to be about 12 nurses, nurse practitioners. There's going to be nutritionists, all focused on providing healthy education, screening for the local residents. So we've been registering people throughout the last few weeks, and we still have openings for more people. So everybody's welcome to come.
That's great. So you talked about the kickoff event times. Want to tell people what times to come tomorrow for the kickoff event?
It starts at 9 o'clock and ends at 12:30. There's a walk with Janet in the morning, which is open to all residents really for any ages from children to the seniors. My two children, Laura and Rose, are going to be partaking in the walk. Unfortunately, with the screening, the health screening, doing blood pressures and cholesterol checks on the children is really not really part of the whole process. We want to focus on people, adults with the screening. But it's from 9 to 12, and we'll have every 15 minutes we're going to be moving people through the system, through the blood pressures, through the education, through the nutrition. So all day from 9 to 12. If you're not going on the walk, it's okay. You can just come and do the screening instead. So from 9 to 12, everybody's welcome.
Actually, we were able to get Emily involved in this whole process also, and she's going to be in charge of the walking program for the 8 weeks. Emily is excellent. Well, Emily and Fred both are excellent volunteers in our community, and they just absolutely agreed to do this, and I'm very happy and very proud to be with them. Also, when Chris was telling you about this was part of his doctorate program in Rutgers, he got me to be a mentor for his class. Okay. So by the way, did I tell you you have to sign this? You're my mentor. Okay. I said, don't worry about it. You're getting 100. It's okay. So we really have a good time even planning it. But it's something I think like Chris said and Larry, that's really good for our community. You know, we've been trying to do, that was one of the things we've been trying to do, is have more things offered to people that they can come to in town and be a part of. And our librarian director, Laura Rifkin, she has really done an outstanding job with helping us out with a lot of programs and making sure that people here in the township have things to do if they don't want to go too far. So, and we have a lot of people here in town who live to be very, very, very old. So obviously, a lot of them tell me they must be in the water or something, so I don't know. So this will help more people live to be very, very old. So
that's great. Yeah. So you, sorry, Gary?
No, I just, it sounds great. I mean, I think it's good to unite the town through the library, the Nicholas Market, as well as what you two are doing. And what not a better time to do it than the new year, you know, healthy.
Of course, the weather's cold. But
right, but that's not going to stop the true
no, goal. I don't think so.
No. But no, I think that's great. I think it's even better that, like, again, you're uniting the town. And because there may be people that want to do this that maybe aren't aware of it or don't know how to go about cultivating something of this. So that the fact that you brought it up through the Valley Hospital as well and everything, I think it's great.
And it's free for them. So that would hopefully encourage some people to come. And even if they just want to stop in.
Right.
If they don't want to do this, they want to stop in, see what it's about. And visit with people, you know, their friends and neighbors. I think, you know, it's good, and hopefully in the future, again, we'll have some more. But the
That's
walking
right.
program, I'm hoping, too, it should be for the next 8 weeks would be good, yeah.
The we have so many experienced professional, healthcare professionals there tomorrow. It's a shame to waste them, right? So they're all going to be there for 4 hours or 3 or 4 hours. They're there for the services of the town. So, and gathering them all together was, everybody was so willing to help. This won't be the last time we do it. We want to do more moving forward. And this is the first time. So, you know, people might not be not realize what's going on, but at least it's worth popping in to see, take a look. If you don't want to have a screening done, it's fine. There's, it's just come down, see what's going on, and, you know, it's something that we want to start making a more frequent occurrence in the town.
I think that's great. In addition to getting like community members more involved, what advice would you have for newcomers or people who are just trying to start their road to being healthy? Is this a good way for them to get involved?
Well, it's a good way for me to get involved. I want to lose a few pounds this year, and so it's definitely. You know, people don't often know how to make that first move. But at the screening, we'll have nutritionists and nurse practitioners and nurses that will just be there to answer questions. Also, if people are worried about their blood pressure, worried about their weight, worried about their lifestyle, even if they don't want to be screened because they're worried about what they might find out, we'll be there to reassure, answer questions. If they don't want to do it this time, it's fine. We can give information on how to move forward with taking it gradual as we move forward. So use the experience of the people down there. It's not just for screening. It's there's probably amongst the people that are there, there's over 100 years worth of nursing experience and healthcare experience that can answer any of your questions.
And I think an even added benefit to that too is a lot of people want to start the new year being healthy, and they may not know how to go about it. Some people start the gym and it's a couple of days and then they drop. But I think this is even better because it's walking. It's something everybody can do for free, like you said, who doesn't love free? And the added benefit of having the nutritionist there to give you better advice on how to become healthier and live that healthier lifestyle you want to live, I think it's like a great step-by-step process that could evolve into something even bigger than what it originally started as. You can maybe even do more into running aspect, exercise aspect, you know, fitness lifestyle aspect, nutrition aspect, all those.
You know, you're exactly right. And while I was researching this whole project to find what the community needs, I reached out to multiple sources, and one of them was the Bergen County Health Rankings and the New Jersey Health Rankings. And it's amazing. New Jersey is the fourth healthiest county in New Bergen County is the fourth healthiest, but we have the highest rate of obesity. We have gyms, more gyms per capita and healthcare facilities, but people are still, there's still more overweight people in Bergen County than most other counties in the state. So I'm not sure if people realize that, but cholesterol checking and blood pressure checking are all part of that whole risk assessment that that people, you know, it's definitely beneficial to find out if they have any other underlying issues related to their health, so we can actually discover things before it becomes a problem. So we have those tools available tomorrow.
Absolutely, yeah, you can definitely see it. Even on my college campus, we have our fitness center as kind of that central hub for inspiring such change. And we have spin classes, and as Garrett was saying, it could be something that booms throughout the community. Maybe we can tackle that problem that Bergen County seems to be facing. Is there anything else you guys feel that you need to share about the Fresh Step program?
Well, I'd just like to mention about some of the professionals that came to help us from the Valley Community Outreach Program, and they were so helpful and so full of good ideas and really helped us, you know, get this thing together, and I'd like to thank them, you know, and of course WCTV for sponsoring you two with your show and also to ask us to be here. I think it's great that we could give this information out to the public, you know, right before it, so they have no excuse tomorrow morning.
Right.
But Healthy Steps is a program that is going to initiate you to become healthy. Chris is providing, and the mayor, screening programs. Last year, my wife and I, we started Couch to 5K. So we've run in two 5Ks. I don't know if we're going to run in the third, but we ran in two. So but the aspect of walking every week, walking around a lake, getting the screening done, improving the programs. You talked about spin classes. You talked about being on the campus. That's what we want to do in the community and to help it to grow.
And, you know, I just want to reinforce that the doors are open tomorrow. Everybody's welcome. We have all the tools to make make it a real healthy day, a healthy start to the new year. Bring the kids, walk with Mayor Janet, enjoy summer Foodtown samples, which are healthy samples. I'm looking forward to the shakes and the kale salad, which they're bringing. They have two nutritionists coming to give nutrition advice. So again, I just want to add, come down, see what's going on, have a look, leave if you want to, but also I think once you see what's going on, you're going to be part of it.
I think some of the council people signed up to come, so mm-hmm. We should have a good morning.
Yeah, no, it definitely sounds like it. I think this is a great way to get that word out and hopefully inspire people to come and join and see what happens with it. I mean, I think it sounds like a great idea.
And one more thing, Larry will be taking blood pressures. So, I mean, just... So, and my wife. My wife's actually, she broke her foot. Gail, she's going to be there tomorrow. She's going to be taking blood. She's a nurse too at the Valley, so she is going to be coming down taking blood pressures also. So we have the real A team down there to look after you.
Sounds
really okay. Great.
It's dedication at its finest. So.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Are we done with this part? I just have one quick announcement.
Absolutely.
Since we have hopefully a lot of people watching the show tonight, I just want to. Inform the residents that if they didn't get their recycling picked up today or didn't have it out on the right day, tomorrow I extended the hours of the yard. Instead of 9 to 1, it will be 9 to 3. And there will be two special dumpsters for recycling. So the person working the yard, Tim Riley, will be there to help you. So if you want to show up tomorrow between 9 to 3, in addition to your regular things that you bring, you can bring the recycling if you didn't have it out or whatever happened. So thank you.
That sounds great.
And that's an added benefit too.
Yeah,
there you go.
That's right. See, yeah. We're getting all kinds of good stuff.
Exercise outdoors as well, and you know,
we're getting all this. A lot of people will be out around tomorrow, so that's good.
Mm,
that's
right. Excellent.
Well, yeah, we want to thank you, everyone here at WCTV wants to thank you all for coming on to our show and talking to us about Healthy Steps. We hope to see a lot of our viewers there soon. I also wanted to thank Garrett and for being here and helping me host.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate it. It's always a pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you for our guests that helped make the town, the show what it is, and our staff and everybody in the control room as well.
Absolutely. We can't do it without them. We have Fred and Emily and Ida and Ricky and Larry. We want to thank Larry for letting us host today, as much as that probably was hard for him to let go. But
I'm surprised. Yeah.
And Jim is here.
Yeah, how could I forget?
Jim is a boyfriend, right?
Yes.
Yeah. I was paying attention before.
Hi, Mom.
Yes.
So. Thank you.
Yes, from all of us here at WCTV, thank you for watching.
Thank you for being here.
We look forward to seeing everybody out in the community and at Healthy Steps.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, WCTV.